NCTV 45, Newcastle, The Train.
The Gathering Banquet Center, an event center located at 2552 Ben Franklin Highway, is the right place for your event. Many buffet dinner packages to choose from, and it makes any event special and elegant. Call 724-652-1149 and let Gatherings serve you.
The Crane Room is a restaurant. The Crane Room is a bar. The Crane Room is a banquet facility. The restaurant will please you time after time with their diverse menu. Ask about their daily specials. See the menu at craneroom.com. The bar gives you an abundance of choices with 35 beers on tap and always changing. Their banquet services are always to perfection. The Crane Room, located at 3009 Wilmington Road in Neshannock Township. Call 724-656-1553.
Seasons change, and when that summer wind blows in, Seasons Change is ready for you. Seasons change, and when the fall brings that autumn rain, and down come the leaves, Seasons Change is ready for you. In the winter, when the wind blows and the snow, Seasons Change is ready for you. And then it's spring and things will bloom, and Seasons Change is ready for you. It's Seasons Change, beautiful shop right in the Majestic, 134 North Street and 139 Fall Street. Seasons Change.
Get to Dad's Bar before the rooster crows. Yes, it's Tony's Lounge. Complete with a great bar, pool, yes, jukebox, and a great seating area that is unbelievable. It'll make you hungry, and a wide selection to choose from, including wings. Yes, specials too. Don't monkey around. Get to Tony's Lounge.
Good afternoon and welcome to Newswatch Midday. This for the 25th of April. And let's get you up to date on the weather. Right now, beautiful blue sky as I look north, 56 degrees, 55% humidity, and we'll get to more of that in a bit. Roughly 10 minutes before we get to the news conference with Governor Wolf. I'm going to preface what will be said by telling you what was put in the mailbag prior to these health updates. Now, yesterday, the Secretary of Health, and excuse me if I feel like I'm preempting a Saturday Night Live skit. You know, I'm going to come right out and say this. The way to gain trust is to be open and honest. I question what's been going on. Here's why. March 21st, Lawrence County and Mercer County have zero cases. Now, according to Mike Kelly, everybody we watched, there's a 2-week quarantine period, and people have gotten better in 2 weeks. Well, with that, they have kept a running total so that to practice a scare tactic. You don't do that, Secretary of Health. On the 10th of April, it said that there were 45 cases in Lawrence County and 36 cases in neighboring Mercer County. People get better in 2 weeks, or they pass away, but they kept it on the books. See, we had people pass away. So the 60 that they have out there transpires that in this county, roughly, there's only 10 cases. Now, are we gaining trust from, you know, I have a heartfelt sympathy for the people in New York, the people of Philadelphia. They're struggling. But I feel as though the Secretary of Health and the governor are missing something here. Remember, the week of the 13th, right after Easter, when I told you about 1%. 1% of the number of cases in the total state. You went from Lawrence County to Erie and across the top to Susquehanna and down the middle. And that was only 1%. It barely made it. We had to round it up. And now, I told you I was going to do it. I told you this morning, and some people get on me, oh, he talks too slow, he takes too long. Okay. The bottom line is, when you're reading this every day and you're going through it, you start to say, it doesn't make sense. The Secretary of Health needs to really re-examine what she's doing. And really think about it. When we get back from this, matter of fact, what I'm going to do, and they're not up and running, I'm going to do a quick Cedars, and hey, listen, I'm going through this because I'm trying to support the local businesses that are around. You folks up in Greenville that are in the sound of my voice, support your local businesses. I've been with the Chamber of Commerce and Janice and talking about them, and I named a pub and quite a few of those places up there. Let's go to sports, and it's going to be quick, folks. We'll be right back.
The Cedars Restaurant in Newcastle wants you to indulge in the food from their pleasing menu.
Program furnished by Sporting Goods, 23 East Washington Street, Newcastle. Call 724-658-2535.
This program sponsored by Penn, Ohio Bottled Water Company. Brian Chez, owner, call 724-498-4760. Brian would be glad to visit you.
Peppers, mouth-watering fruit, fine dressings, apples, meats. This place looks so familiar, everyone in Newcastle has to know about it. Yes, it reminds you of when you were growing up, right in downtown Newcastle. Look at those fine lunch meats and ethnic foods. Yes, it's Joseph's.
Okay, we're back, and as I hustle along, I'm watching what is going on in Harrisburg. Currently 56 degrees, and here you go with 55% humidity, winds from the southeast at 6, barometric pressure 30, and dew point 40, visibility 10. I give that to you. We got lucky, folks, because we weren't supposed to have this kind of a day today, and we're a minute before hitting towards the governor. But aren't these amazing stats? He's so worried that somebody's going to drive from Philadelphia to Sharon, Crawford County, Lawrence, Erie. Are you kidding me? They weren't doing that at the beginning of time when this started. They're not going to do it now. You've got to keep the place open. And after listening to Mike Kelly yesterday, congressman, some of the comments were maybe the middle of the month, the end of the month. People have not received money. I don't know if you understand. Let me make it clear to you, Harrisburg. Here we gotta go.
Update on COVID-19.
As of 12 a.m. this morning, we have 1,397
new cases of COVID-19.
This brings our statewide total now to 40,000 who have tested positive for COVID-19, who have tested positive for COVID-19. In all, approximately 2,278 of our total cases are in healthcare workers. Approximately 6,544 of our total cases are associated with 425 long-term care living facilities, which includes nursing homes and personal care homes and other congregate settings. Tragically, we have now had 1,537 deaths among those who have tested positive for COVID-19. And to date, all of the deaths have been in adult patients. As of this morning, hospitals are reporting that approximately 2,746 patients are currently hospitalized with COVID-19. 662 of those hospitalized have required the use of a ventilator or a breathing machine. Across our healthcare system, approximately 47% of hospital beds, 40% of intensive care unit beds, and nearly 70% of our ventilators are still available. We know that changes to our daily way of life has been very difficult for Pennsylvanians, and the governor highlighted several aspects of this in regards to mental health yesterday. Major disruptions to daily schedules has been even more difficult for Pennsylvanians with intellectual disabilities and autism who rely upon these routines. And it's also very difficult for those who care for them. People with intellectual disabilities or autism experience the world somewhat differently, and they may not understand why their routine has been so disrupted. They have a range of needs, sometimes including intense medical care, to help them with managing finances and shopping for food. Some require 24-hour care, and some are able to live on their own with support. The families who care for them, who rely on support networks like teachers and teachers' aides, day services, providers, and even employers to help keep their loved ones safe, are also very impacted by the COVID-19 global pandemic. Some families are not able to have services in their home as they normally would, meaning they can't get out even to obtain the basic necessities of life, like food and obtaining medications. Organizations like the ARC of Pennsylvania and the Autism Society of Pennsylvania have recommended some steps for these impacted families. Stay calm by connecting to great resources online, like virtual tours of museums, exercise, and stress reduction classes. Stay home by connecting to family, friends, and community through video chatting. And stay safe by connecting with your medical or intellectual disability provider through telehealth. If you are an individual or family member who needs assistance, please contact the statewide support and referral helpline at 855-284-8505. Again, 855-284-8505. And I want to thank the direct care providers who are literally putting their lives on the line to care for Pennsylvanians with intellectual disabilities or autism. Your hard work and dedication and bravery has not gone unnoticed. Now, here are my daily reminders. Please wash your hands with soap and water for at least 20 seconds, or the time that it takes to sing Happy Birthday twice, or use hand sanitizer if soap and water are not available. Cover any coughs or sneezes with your elbow, not with your hands, and try not to touch your face, especially after touching surfaces. Clean surfaces frequently. And if you have to go out for life-sustaining activities, please wear a mask if you're going to come into contact with others. These everyday prevention measures can help slow the spread of the dangerous virus, COVID-19, and give hope to our families and our communities that we can and will recover together. If you have questions about your health, please contact your healthcare provider. And if you need mental health resources because you or someone you know is experiencing a mental health crisis, please contact the crisis text line by texting PA to 741741 or call the statewide support and referral helpline at 1-855-284-2494. Again, 1-855-284-2494. For the most reliable information related to Pennsylvania's response, please visit our website at health.pa.gov. And what is most important for Pennsylvanians to remember, stay calm, stay home, and stay safe. And now I'm pleased to answer questions.
Thank you, Secretary. Our first question is from Capital Star. Some experts estimate we'll need 750,000 tests weekly nationwide to start reopening. What would Pennsylvania need?
So I don't have a specific number for you, but we certainly will need to increase our testing resources. And we are working on that as we speak. There was a phone call just as before I came here about how we might accessing more testing resources. We're particularly going to want to target testing in those areas that the governor identifies that will go from red to yellow. We're going to want to make sure that we're able to do testing of even mildly symptomatic Pennsylvanians so that we can prevent any potential outbreak in those regions.
Our next question is from WKOK. When considering metrics for advancing regions from one phase of reopening to the next, will hospitals surge capacity and bed availability be considered?
It will. And that's one of the reasons, actually, why we're looking on a regional basis, because some of the particular rural counties don't have a lot of hospitals. But we will need to take in consideration the regional availability of beds and resources to take care of patients if we do see an outbreak of COVID-19.
Our next question is from WTAJ. Cambria County has 20 confirmed cases, but it is in the same region as Allegheny, which has nearly 1,200. Would the state consider allowing counties with few cases, such as Cambria and Blair, to reopen before other counties in their region?
Well, we're going to take many things into consideration, including the regions, but also the specific case ratio and number of cases in each county. So we're going to take all of that into consideration.
Our next question is from the Philadelphia Inquirer. Does this shortage of testing materials remain a problem? And can you comment on how that may affect plans to reopen regions of the state?
So the shortage of testing resources has been a problem, and that includes all aspects of testing. It has included the swabs, the viral media, or now it can be regular normal saline or sterile salt water that is used when after we collect the specimen, in terms of the extraction chemicals and the testing chemicals. So it all has been a challenge in terms of that resource supply. Overall, I think we're doing somewhat better in terms of that. Our state laboratory in the last week has obtained a significant number of supplies so we can do more testing. And we have heard from many hospitals and health systems that they are doing better with their reagents and they're able to expand their own testing. But we need to watch the supply chain really carefully. We actually had a phone call with the federal government several days ago with Health and Human Services and the CDC and the White House to discuss that. And hopefully we'll be able to have a more consistent supply chain of those resources. I do not expect at this time that any shortages will impact our ability to do testing in the regions that we identify that will go from red to yellow.
This question is from WNEP. Regarding the six regions identified by your Bureau of Community Health Systems, how many years ago did the Department of Health first carve out those regions, and what criteria did it use to determine which counties would be part of which region?
So we've actually researched this. It was back in the 60s that those regions were identified, and I don't know exactly what the rationale for including different counties in different regions, but the Department of Health has been working with these regions for well over 50 years, and it is how our state health centers and their administration are identified. It is how the regions we are in terms of the hospital association and those regions are identified. And so the Department of Health has been using this schema, but we don't want any specific schema of regions to hinder our progress with this. It's a way that we start thinking about the regions.
The Altoona Mirror has a question. Governor Wolf talked about mental health yesterday. How stressful has the last couple months been for your department?
Well, thank you for asking. The Department of Health has absolutely fantastic healthcare professionals in all aspects of our department. We have talked about our epidemiologists or our disease detectives. We've talked about our great public health nurses, but you have to remember our laboratory technicians. I believe this is health laboratory week, and so they've been working very hard. And then we have all aspects of the department that have been working long hours on behalf of public health. And so I would like to thank them. They're doing very well, but it's been very challenging.
This question is from WESA. Congressman Connor Lamb says that he's been told the federal government will not be providing any more personal protective equipment to Pennsylvania. Assuming that's true, do you know why the federal government has made that decision, and what will the impact be on the ability to provide testing and treatment?
Mm-hmm. We have discussed this with the congressman and actually all of our federal delegation. So at this time, we did receive in the last number of weeks two shipments from the federal government of the N95 masks, those special masks that are used by healthcare personnel as they care for patients with COVID-19. So at the moment, we're doing much better in terms of supply. Where we're low is actually in traditional medical surgical procedure masks, hospital gowns, and gloves. We have been told that at this time, the national stockpile is very, very low in those materials, and we should not expect any from the federal government at this time. Hopefully, they'll be able to replace some of their supply. We are looking with the governor's office really everywhere in the United States and even other places globally to try to find access for those resources. But we're also going to rely upon our excellent hospitals and health systems and the hospital association through their mutual aid agreement. And this has actually happened, that we know that that supplies from the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, from Penn State Health, from Geisinger and other health systems has gone to stressed hospitals in Philadelphia, such as gowns and masks and gloves, to be able to allow them to take care of sick patients with COVID-19. So we're going to look for potentially more from the federal stockpile. We're going to try to find resources anywhere we can find them, and then we're going to rely upon our hospitals and fantastic health systems to help supply it where we need it most, which is in the moment in the Southeast.
This question from the Beaver County Times is also in relation to the comment from Congressman Lamb. What effect does this have on the state's ability to fight the pandemic, especially in the southeast portion of the state, and reopen on a regional basis beginning May 8th?
So I do not think it'll impact it. Again, I just went through some of the various ways. We will make sure that hospitals in the southeast or anywhere that are battling COVID-19 have the supplies that they need. And so we work through our healthcare coalitions and the hospital association to let us know when those needs are, and then we work to fill them. I do not think this will challenge the reopening process or counties and regions going from red to yellow. We'll have to make sure that those hospitals are stocked, but those are by definition areas that are much less affected by COVID-19.
And as a follow-up to that, are you able to say, in terms of the request for PPE, how many of each things, like masks, gloves, and gowns, were requested?
No, I don't have that specifics. I also want to point out, though, it's not only hospitals that need PPE. It's other healthcare professionals, particularly, as we've been mentioning, the challenges in long-term care living facilities, particularly our staff in nursing homes, personal care homes, and other congregate living centers. They need PPE as well.
This question is from WKYW Radio. What are the chances that Pennsylvanians will have to continue to practice social distancing throughout the summer? Does this mean no swimming pools, public parks, baseball, and summer camp? Are there guidelines that would allow people to participate in these activities safely?
Well, you know, that's the summer, and we will see how things will go in the summer. Right now, it's still April. We know from Dr. Fauci and other professionals that public health professionals that the virus determines the timeline. We don't determine the timeline. We are starting on May 8th, rollout, this progressive reopening, and counties and regions going from red to yellow. It's much too soon to decide what things will look like in the middle of the summer.
We have another question from KYW Radio. How will openings of non-essential businesses in other parts of the country impact the length of time we need to stay closed here in Pennsylvania? Will there be an impact on us here if others decide they need to start gathering and socializing?
Well, you know, it's a global society, and certainly global events have impacted events in the United States. It is natural to think that what happens in other states impacts Pennsylvania. But we're going to concentrate right now on Pennsylvania and our own citizens and residents, and do what's right for Pennsylvania, and then we'll deal in, with other impacts from the United States as we go.
This question is from WKOK. What do you think the new normal may look like in the months ahead at restaurants, playgrounds, or carnivals? How do crowds and social distancing mix in the future?
The only thing I would say is I think that it will be a new normal. I think that the idea, and the governor has spoken about this, that we're going to go back exactly to how we were before, at least for the foreseeable future, is unlikely. I think that there will be a new normal. But as the governor often says, Pennsylvanians are strong and resilient, and we will get through this.
KYW Radio would also like to know, is our food supply chain still running as it should? Have there been disruptions due to the impact on New York and New Jersey? How can we be confident that we will continue to have access to necessities if stay-at-home and social distancing guidelines remain in place for the long term?
Well, there have been challenges to the food supply globally, nationally, regionally, and in Pennsylvania. I mean, right now in Pennsylvania, we've had many food manufacturing and supply businesses that have been impacted in terms of their workers who have COVID-19. We have had extensive discussions with Secretary Redding of the Department of Agriculture and the governor's office, and we have spoken with the food manufacturers, we've spoken with the food store organizations, and we'll work through this, and we'll make sure that the food chain is intact, and so people can get the food they need. I'd like to point out this is a particular concern of Governor Wolf. He asks us every day at our senior staff meetings about the food supply chain and making sure that every Pennsylvanian gets the food that they need.
This question is from Spotlight PA. Given the complicated nature of maintaining multiple death reporting systems, this is a yes or no question, were any of the more than 200 deaths rescinded on Thursday due to duplicate records mistakenly in the count?
It's going to be hard to do a yes or no question. I'm going to say I'll have to get back to you on that specific. I don't really think it was duplicates. It was more getting more data on the ones that we reported, and so we decided to pull it back. So I guess I'll say no, but it's more nuanced than that.
We have another question from KYW Radio. The New York governor has said there's evidence that significantly more residents have had the virus than have been tested for it, indicating the virus may be more widespread and perhaps less deadly than originally thought. What is your opinion about this?
Well, I think that's correct. Now, I know there's a study using antibody testing in New York. Those studies need to be repeated and have further studies to judge their impact. But I have said before, we know that there are more cases of COVID-19 than we have been able to detect. We know that some patients with COVID-19 have no symptoms. We know that some patients have very mild symptoms and haven't gotten tested. We don't know exactly how many they are. I think that that's going to be very important in our surveillance in the future when we are able to do that on a wide, that type of either virus testing or the antibody testing in the future. But it is clear that there are many more people in Pennsylvania and in any state that have had COVID-19 than we exactly know of this time. And that does influence the death rate. I mean, our death rate right now is almost four in terms of the number per 100 that have passed away. We know that that's not exactly true. Data from China indicated approximately 2 out of 100. Other areas maybe down closer to 1 out of 100. So as we get more surveillance data, we'll be able to know that number. I do want to point out, however, that the death rate of the flu, of influenza, is 0.1. So even if it's approximately 1 out of 100 or a little more, that's still 10 times the death rate than it is for influenza.
We have a number of questions from News Talk 104.1 about death counts and coroners. So of the Of the 201 deaths removed earlier this week, how many were duplicated in two counties?
So I don't know. I don't have that granular data. I know that there were concerns in terms of reconciling our different data systems. And so we pulled back the quote unquote probable deaths. And so for the foreseeable future, the deaths that I report will be confirmed deaths. And we had a in-depth discussion with our team in terms of working with the coroners today. We are going to be reaching out to the Coroners Association and the president and executive director to have a meeting next week. And we want to make sure we can do everything we can to work collaboratively with the Coroners Association.
Of the current death total, how many deaths had pre-existing conditions that may have contributed to their death?
A significant amount. I don't have that specific number, but I know that many patients have had comorbid conditions, and we've talked about this, such as heart disease, such as hypertension, high blood pressure, such as lung disease, particularly chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. That includes emphysema and chronic bronchitis, and diabetes and kidney disease. And so, you know, the majority of deaths have been in seniors. The majority of deaths have been in patients in nursing homes. Many of those patients have a comorbid condition, sometimes clusters of comorbid conditions, and that puts them at particular risk from contracting COVID-19 and from getting very ill and tragically passing away from COVID-19.
As a follow-up, why is the online system for COVID-19-related deaths only giving three options for cause of death? And all related to COVID-19.
I don't have specific details about that. We'll have to check with our staff.
I believe you may have answered this, but in case there's more to elaborate, what guidance will you share with Rep. Benninghoff in your meeting later today as it relates to death counts being shared with county coroners?
Well, we want to work with the county coroners, and our death counts are all available online, actually. But we want to work really closely with the Coroners Association. Again, we had a meeting about that today, and we're going to be reaching out today to the Coroners Association president and executive director to schedule a meeting, to listen to them, to have for us to be able to explain our opinion and to work out a solution and a path forward.
When will right-to-know law requests of your office begin to be answered?
I don't know the answer to that question. I mean, one of the main reasons why we're not doing that is that we're in the middle of a global pandemic. In addition to all of our fantastic, we've talked about our epidemiologists, our lab technicians, et cetera, our attorneys are working overtime, and we have full staffing at our incident command by attorneys to work through many different legal issues. And so at the present time, we're really not able to do that.
Moving on to a question from WJAC. What do you say to frustrated politicians and citizens who are increasingly telling us they feel like that because of the back and forth with presumed positive cases and the rationale being used for reopening the state, that they are increasingly skeptical of how the crisis is being handled and about information coming out of these briefings?
Well, we are trying to be as absolutely transparent as possible. The governor and I have been doing briefings for months now. I can't even remember how many months. And really trying to relay that information in a clear, concise way. Sometimes there are challenges in terms of the data, especially with so many cases and so many deaths. And so really the one thing we did push out was this idea of presumed probable death, and then we had problems reconciling it, and so we came out and said that, and then we're just doing the confirmed death. So I think that we've been as open as possible in these briefings and on the website, and thank you for your support.
You have one more question from News Talk 104.1. What is the biggest obstacle for the Department of Health to being tracking recovered cases of COVID-19?
Well, we're not able to track the specific recoveries of patients of COVID-19. So if you think about all the things that we're doing, we're trying to track new cases of COVID-19. We're trying to track track in terms of the long-term care living facilities and the things that they need, the personal care homes and the nursing homes that are very challenged. We're trying to work with the companies in the food chain. We're working with our county municipal health department partners. We want to work with the coroners. We're willing really working with many different stakeholders to make sure that we are tracking this and reporting it accurately. As we've said, we have more than 40,000 cases of COVID-19. We do not have the personnel, and be honest with you, we will not have the personnel to call all of them to see when they recovered. What we're going to be concentrating on now is that path forward about going in counties, going from red to yellow. That's going to take a significant amount of effort in terms of making sure that we have the testing available, that we diagnose patients who have COVID-19, that we do appropriate isolation, that we do the case investigations of those, the contact tracing of contacts, and then making sure that they are notified and that they quarantine. I can't tell you how much work that means. We're going to have to add some staff. We do not have the ability to call all 40,000 people and see when and how long and when they recovered.
Our next question is from the Citizen's Voice. Of the COVID-19 tests that have been given at the Mohegan Sun Arena site in Wilkes-Barre Township, how many have come back positive?
We have that data. I don't have that data at my fingertips. It had a relatively low positivity rate, not as many positive as we might have thought. All of those tests are being done actually at our state laboratory in Exton. But we can get you that information. I just don't have it at my fingertips.
This question is from the Pittsburgh Business Times. Can you give us a sense of how the virus is being transmitted, given it has been many weeks since the stay-at-home order and business closures have been instituted? Is it among healthcare workers, essential workers, people who aren't heeding the stay-at-home order?
Well, it's being transmitted by anybody who's not just at home. And so there are lots of reasons why people might not be at home. They might be essential workers. They might be working in healthcare, in hospitals or offices. They might be working in long-term care living facilities, et cetera. In addition, people have to go out and to get food and medical supplies and medicines. And all those stores have to be staffed by people. We have to make sure that those supply chains exist. So even though there is a general stay-at-home order, with just the businesses associated with essential activities and daily living, there are still people who have to be out and about. Whenever that is true, there is going to be transmission of this very contagious virus. That's why we've recommended the mask order. And remember, my mask protects you, and your mask protects me. And if you're both wearing masks, there is more protection. But it's not 100%. And so there continues to be spread of COVID-19. The biggest areas where there's spread is where there's more population density. That's why we have more cases in the Southeast.
This question's from the Post-Gazette. How important is contact tracing to the plan to reopen the state?
Very important. As I was mentioning, in terms of testing, isolating people who are positive, doing case investigations, then contact tracing and quarantining the contacts, all of that will be very, very important. We're developing those plans as we speak. They should be ready this week. And we'll be implementing them as the governor's order comes down on May 8th to go for certain counties and regions to go from red to yellow.
We have a question from the Bucks County Courier on benchmark. To clarify the benchmark confusion, is the formula to calculate the counties, the number of cases today, the number of cases 14 days ago, divided by population of 100,000? Under that formula, the statewide rate would be 145 as of Friday's numbers. Does that sound correct?
I am not facile enough with numbers to do that calculation in my head, but I have it all written down, so I'm going to read it to you. One of the target goals for reopening has been set at having fewer than 50 new confirmed cases per 100,000 population reported to the department in the previous 14 days. So, for example, an area with a population of 800,000 people would need to have fewer than 400 new confirmed cases reported in the past 14 days to meet the target. An assessment will determine if the target has been met and will work closely with county and local governments to enable the communities to reopen and transition back to work. But that's not the only factor. And I know there's been a lot of attention on it, and I understand that. It's a metric that we put out, and it is not intuitively obvious, and again, I can't do the calculations in my head, but there are many other things, and we've been talking about them today. It includes the availability to do testing. It includes our ability to do those case investigations and contact tracing. It includes the number of high-risk settings that are there, such as personal care homes and long-term care living facilities, et cetera. And it includes the stability and the ability of hospitals to be able to take care of patients. In addition, we're going to be relying upon a modeling dashboard by Carnegie Mellon University. We will be considering all of that information, making recommendations to the governor, and eventually the governor will make his decision. So that is a metric that we're going to be able to kind of compare from region to region or county to county, but it's by far, it's not the only thing we're looking at.
Thank you. Our last question today is from ABC 27. Certain counties have much higher COVID-19 death rates than others. For example, Northampton County has nearly 3%. Is the Department of Health looking into why? Does it have to do with the local hospital's ability to treat patients or perhaps a different strain of the virus?
I don't think it's a different strain of the virus in this locality, and I think that we need to do a deeper dive on that. I think we do need to look in terms of the healthcare systems, but also the age of individuals in those regions and how many long-term care living facilities. As we've been talking about all day, we know that seniors are more susceptible to getting the virus and more susceptible from having complications and tragically passing away. So I think there's a lot of different demographic factors that will go into that, and we'll need to do a deeper dive. There are different strains of the virus. It's really more, there's different strains from Europe than there might be in the United States, from Asia, Australia, et cetera. Maybe small differences on the West Coast or East Coast, but those differences have not proven to be clinically significant at this time.
Thank you. Those are all the questions we have today. Thank you so much, Secretary. We will have our next briefing on Monday.
Now, as we, it was interesting. She said they're not able to track who gets well. The 14-day period, that's the quarantine period that they had decided on. Okay? And that's really remarkable that she would say that. Because in 14 days, somebody is well. You can't take the people that were sick in March and keep them in and say the active cases are at 60. So what the way they're tracking it is faulty. I have to disagree. If somebody was sick with the flu in March, we don't say, oh, well, it's April, you're still sick with the flu. Unless they had a relapse or something else happened. These numbers are based on their numbers. April 10th. 45 cases. Five people died. To say that there's only 10 to 15 cases in Lawrence County is a reasonable guess. If you're not tracking, it could even be lower. Why could it be lower? Well, because the amount, the nearly 1%, nearly 1%, 5 to 12. So that's nearly 2%, okay? So you don't have a big percentage under 18, nearly 6%, 19 to 24. So you don't even have 10% under 24. The question you have to ask, and it's gone down 2%. This is a statewide number, 38% between 25 and 49. If our numbers here of the people, and her excuse was they don't have enough people. It's like you can hire an accounting firm to do this. Nearly 28% between 60 and near 50 and 64, and nearly 26% between 65 and older. I haven't seen any of those percentages with respect to Lawrence County or even heard of any of them. So they're really weak. Now, the Wolf administration's elaborates on data-driven reopening standards. Enough testing for individuals with symptoms and targeted populations, such as those high risk, high healthcare personnel and first responders. Now they're starting to talk about enough tests. But the tests don't actually test. It tests on whether you're susceptible to get it. That's what I was told. Robust case investigations, tracking and infrastructure in place to facilitate early identification. Identification on areas of high risk settings. The areas that have high risk settings, my dear governor, are places with a high transient population, or those folks that have jobs that require them to go into areas that are the hot areas, the red areas. We're not even pink here. You go down the street and folks don't even give you a sneeze. There's not even a person that has a runny nose. So, as I said when I uncovered the 1%, if you take their number 60 and put it over 48,000. They based it on 100,000. I don't think we're a county of 100,000 anymore. It would be 0.127%. It's not even 1% of the county here that would be sick. Well, that's going to do it for Newswatch Midday. I'm going to go to the weather. We'll have a wrap up and we'll be right back.
BSB. Big Shot Bobs are the wings for me. 50 flavors, make it right, you see. BSB has sandwiches you have to try. Stop in and you'll know why. Every day of the week you see. Call or stop in to BSB. Big Shot Bob's will be your favorite place, just like me.
Easy clean. Car and van wash, where your clean wash is our goal. Rainy low of 48. How's your Sunday looking? Well, folks, as you take a look at local radar, it looks pretty clear That's a little deceptive. The national scene showing it a little bit better. Off to our west, you see those patches of blue? That's the rain that's heading our way. And, you know, we lucked out Saturday with some early morning sunshine and what have you. So this is going to be interesting because that was supposed to be a rain day. So let's get right to the forecast. And here you go. Last night's overnight low, 48 with rain. Your Sunday, showers, 53. And chance of precip, 90%. Now, as you get into Sunday night, cloudy, a low of 39. Chance of rain is 40%. So it's not going to really stop. As you wake up on Monday, clouds will start to clear. Partly sunny, 56. And then Monday night, partly cloudy, a low of 38. Your Tuesday, partly sunny, 61. There's a slight chance of rain, but I think you get out of Wednesday, Tuesday okay. But you're not getting out of Wednesday. Tuesday night, mostly cloudy, 49, 60% chance of rain, and that's why you're not getting out of Wednesday. Wednesday, high of 63, 90% chance of rain. Wednesday night, low of 49, 90% chance of rain. Thursday, 58, 80% chance of rain. Thursday night, mostly cloudy, 45, 50% chance of rain. And then your Friday, mostly cloudy, a high of 58 with a 50% chance of rain. So you're going to be getting a little soaked as it goes on, and that back part of the back part of the week Not so great. Now, this was, and wow, every once in a while it'll get you. This was Lawrence County 45 weather.
Tuscany Square Restaurant, 3470 Wilmington Road, where old world charm meets today's modern conveniences. You'll enjoy their spacious, comfortable seating, their fresh ingredients that go into making every dish, whether it's pizza or that just right entree. Tuscany Square Restaurant, we're here to serve you. Call 724-654-3065.
Simple elegance in a majestic setting. Yes, right here in downtown Newcastle, minutes away from shopping, seconds from a gas station, and let's not forget pastries, a restaurant, and oh yes, the schools. The majestic. For that majestic lifestyle, right in the greatest castle, Newcastle. Come by and take a look.
Hear ye, hear ye. This is your old buddy Ben, speaking for Ben Franklin's Tap Room, Grill, and Bottle Shop for the best ribs and sandwiches and dinners and much, much more. It's Ben Franklin's Tap Room, Grill, and Bottle Shop. Food, beverages, this is a place you want to try, and it's right close by. Hope to see you.
There's more than meets the eye. Gotta get them in Newcastle, I try. They're a small town for living. Look around.
Special thanks going out to Town Mall Pizza for sponsorship of this program, located in the Cascade Galleria, Newcastle.
At our law firm, we see you. Come see us at lgkg.com.
Today's programming is brought to you by NCTV 45 and NC Radio 450, Newcastle's community television station.
Things I want to, why did I say based on 48? Because I was being conservative. They're using the department by the 2018 count, population counts. That's what they're using in the Bureau of Health. So if that's what they're using and we put 60 and we divide it by 72,000, because that's an approximate, now we're at 0.08%. The number just keeps going down. Folks, the number just keeps going down. That's one. Number two, okay, as I check these off on my list, they've been adding, taking away, adding, taking away. So now they have it at 61 with 5 deaths. Well, you take the 5 deaths right off the smack, that gets you down to 56. And then you take the 45 off the 56, that gets you down to 9. We don't have enough people to track it. Just as not good information. You're not even figuring the numbers correctly. With that, Venango County had 7. It's not even close, and horseshoe is in hand grenades, the faulty way that you're doing this. It's so wash your hands, sing happy birthday twice, and all that stuff. And make sure that you tell a friend and have a friend tell a friend about NCTV 45. They'll be glad you did. And when they say, oh, I don't watch a lot of TV, you tell them that NCTV 45 is available anytime on your time. Yes, a train that runs on your schedule. That's NCTV 45. And I send this out to our illustrious Secretary of Health, who, I'm sorry, deserves a lot of criticism in a job that I don't feel personally was well done. This is what a fool believes. And you take it easy. Have a great day. Make sure you get that second glass of lemonade, coffee, whatever it may be. And have a super day. What I call...
Never coming near what you wanted to say. Only to realize it never really was. Anybody else would surely know. Here's what you learn.